this picture earlier. The crucial thing about having a meeting at the General Assembly is that it's the top of the tree. Rather than being down here, like we normally are, we go to the top of the tree, and this is like the most important part of the United Nations decision making is the General Assembly. So this room, this is what it looks like. This room is huge. This was the message last time we had an UNGAS. They don't happen very often. An UNGAS can be on any topic. It can be on drugs, or it can be on HIV, or development, or children, or women, any topic. But last time we had an UNGAS on drugs was 1998. So it's quite a while ago. And the message was, a drug-free world, we can do it. And the goal was that by 2008, we were going to have a drug-free world. But that's the message last time. And that's why when we had another UNGAS last year, in 2016, it was seen as a real opportunity for us to have a different target. You know, not to again be talking about a drug-free world, but to actually be talking about reform and ending the war on drugs. So IVPC, as I said earlier, we're a network of 170 plus NGOs all around the world. So we worked with all of our members to create, and we were talking about maybe NPD need to do this, to think about what your requests are, what your messages are. We created these five asks, five things that we wanted as a network from the UNGAS, okay? Some of which we knew wouldn't happen, but they were important for us to be asking for. You know, sometimes you have to ask for things that you know you're not gonna get, yeah? But you still, it's important that you still ask for the solution you want, even though you might get a compromise, yeah? And it's similar for us here. So I'm just gonna talk through these quickly and kind of talk about what happened at the UNGAS, okay? And talk about whether or not we were successful. So the first thing we wanted was an open and inclusive debate. We wanted the debate to involve everybody, okay? It was a real opportunity. And we kind of got that. So there was more civil society at the UNGAS than ever before. Okay? There were presentations from networks of people who use drugs, there were presentations from NGOs from around the world. And all of the UN agencies, there were, I think, 26 submissions, I think it is. All the UN agencies submitted a report to say, this is how drug policy impacts our work. And most of those called for decriminalisation and harm reduction. They were good. So in that sense, it was positive. But the debate was not inclusive in that it still didn't really consider the new options. It didn't really consider cannabis policy reform. It didn't really consider legalization because they couldn't reach consensus on any of these issues. The second point was to reset the objectives. Now, by this I mean, when you go to Vienna, and Olga, you mentioned this earlier, when a country makes a presentation, they are talking about success in terms of how many people they've arrested and how many tons of heroin they've seized, okay? No one is talking about impact, because you can arrest thousands of people, but if there's no change in the drug market, or the drug market's just getting worse, or is getting bigger, then what's the point? Then, you know, what you're doing does not work. But they don't talk about this. And we really wanted the UNGAS to be an opportunity to talk about this. Now what happened in the end, if you can see this map, the countries in green are the ones that in their country statements spoke up and they said, we need a new approach. We need a new paradigm, we need a new approach, the war on drugs has failed, okay? The ones in red are the countries that said, war on drugs, we need to carry on. Yeah? And it's very interesting map because you can see the divide. You can see the divide. Even the USA, Remember I said President Nixon was the guy that first created the words war on drugs? Yeah? Even the USA are now saying we need to do something different, mainly because all those states in the USA have now legalized cannabis, so they can't keep fighting war on drugs when they're not doing it in their own country. But it's a very interesting divide between the countries, some of whom want to carry on doing what we do, including a lot of Asia and obviously Russia. Okay? But other countries, particularly in Latin America, saying we need to do something different. We can't keep doing this same thing. So there was a lot of support for new approaches. There was a lot of discussion about new approaches. But when it came to actually agreeing the final document by consensus, it didn't happen. Because as you can see, there is no consensus. They cannot agree on what happens next. So the fourth one, and we just spoke about this earlier with the beautiful tree here, ending criminalization, decriminalizing drugs. For us, that was something we expected from the UNGAS because the drug treaties, and I'll go into this in a bit later, but the drug laws make it clear that you are allowed to decriminalize. The treaties are very clear. At no point in any of the treaties does it say you have got to criminalize drug users. That's something that governments have done by themselves. Okay, so we were really hoping we'd get some good statements. And as part of that, obviously, we also wanted to end the death penalty, and we wanted more proportionate sentences. So sentences that, even sentences for drug supply, high-level drug supply, even they need to be fair. Because at the moment, in many countries, you can get a bigger sentence for drug supply than you can for murder, which is completely wrong, completely inappropriate. And then the last one, obviously, was we wanted a strong commitment to a harm reduction. Okay? Now, again, they could not agree the words harm reduction. And I'll show you why now with another map. This map shows you all of the countries in green that spoke in favour of harm reduction. Okay? The European Union all spoke together with one voice, and they all said harm reduction is good. Even some of the Latin American countries, that's Ghana, I think, in Africa.
Yes.
Lots of countries speaking in favour of harm reduction. Just two countries, China and Singapore, they were the only ones that in their speeches said harm reduction doesn't work, harm reduction is a bad idea. China said that harm reduction is basically legalising. So we can't do it because you're basically legalising drugs. Okay? But remember what I was saying about consensus, yeah? Because they have to reach consensus. Because two countries objected, the words did not make it into the document. Which is really, it's very frustrating and very sad. But we did manage to get the strongest agreement yet on needle and syringe programs, medically assisted treatment, as they call it, so that includes methadone and buprenorphine, and also naloxone. For the first time ever, naloxone was mentioned in the document. So we did win
some.
And I think that's really the message from the UNGAS, is we were asking for some big things, we were asking for a lot of things, things that to us are very sensible. We did win a lot at the UNGAS, but we didn't win as much as we wanted. You know, so it's kind of like a mixed feeling. We did win some things, we did lose some others. The death penalty, again, there was no consensus. The countries that had the death penalty did not want to talk about it. And the European Union and others really wanted to talk about it because they're very against the death penalty. So in the end, they couldn't even agree language that acknowledged that the death penalty existed. They couldn't even agree that, because the countries that had the death penalty just did not want to talk about it at all. Good or bad, they were just like, do not put that in the document. So again, very frustrating. So the UNGAS was a kind of It was a big moment for us, and there's some other big moments coming up in the future. But what I really want to do now is talk about, because I've talked a lot about the international, the United Nations, and it all is, it's a strange little circus, it's a strange world that is a long way away from the work you do sometimes. So what I want to do now is just talk about how the international things affect you and the work you do in your city, in your country, on the ground, because I think this is really important. The first thing to say is that international laws and the international agreements, they are the things that shape most countries' drug policies. In fact, most countries, if you look at your national drug law, it will either reference one of the international laws, or in the case of the UK, it's actually the same year as one of the international laws. We just brought it in at the same time. So the international laws, they really help to shape national policy. Now some governments, as we've talked about this morning, are very, they pick some bits and they leave others. So they forget the health and well-being bit and they just focus on the prohibition part, yeah? But the international drug laws have a huge impact. So what we've done is, we've gone through some of the things that we might want to advocate for. And we've given it a score. It's either a green light, meaning it is allowed, an orange light, meaning possibly, and a red light to mean no. So I'm just going to go through some of these now. So the first one is decriminalisation, okay? Removing criminal penalties. But as I said before, that doesn't mean that drug use is allowed. It just means that it's no longer criminal, okay? Now the most important thing to know is that all three of the drug laws, remember there's 1961, 1971 and 1988, okay? All three of those laws say that you can provide alternatives to incarceration. They all have a section in there that says you can provide, they actually say alternatives or additional measures to incarceration and punishment, okay? So you do not need to punish. You do not need to imprison, okay? You can provide alternatives. They don't mention harm reduction because, as I said, we didn't really know about harm reduction until after that was written. So they talk about treatment, social reintegration, things like this. But the message is clear. You can provide alternatives, okay? The INCB, remember I talked about them earlier? They're the watchdogs, the guardians of the treaties. They have made lots of statements now to say, yes, decriminalisation is okay. They don't call it decriminalisation. They don't like that word. They will call it alternatives to incarceration or alternatives to punishment. Yeah? But the message is the same. Governments are allowed to provide alternatives. And this is why we're hoping UNODC and INCB will be very supportive of what you're proposing in Georgia. Because it's allowed, it is a green light.
Although there's this tricky point that government has been trying to tell us that, okay, let's depenalize, but let's keep them criminal record, and we've been arguing.
Yeah.
That. And you know, this is the tricky point.
Yeah.
That's basically our biggest fear. That
they won't go far enough.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah. But like I say, I think we're in a very good position, but all of those international organisations, whereas 10 years ago we wouldn't have had much support, we now have a lot of support. There's a lot more understanding. You saw that joint statement earlier with 12 agencies. They're all saying the same thing now, that we have to decriminalise. So that is a green light, and I really want you to take that message away with you. This is something that is allowed. Harm reduction is a green light, okay? It's not mentioned by name because they didn't know it was called that, okay? But it is in there. You are providing health services, protecting people's health is the reason that these treaties exist. Yeah, it's in the first line of every treaty. Now, crucially, in 2002, the United Nations Legal Affairs section were asked to do to look at the case and to say, is harm reduction legal or not? And they came back and said, yes, it is. It's completely within the spirit of these conventions. They've never reworded the conventions because they don't. They just don't want to do that. But harm reduction is allowed and is now universally supported across the United Nations. Okay, so that's another green line, very important green line. Wiggle room means flexibility. So within the conventions are always worded, all international law is worded in a way that allows for interpretation. You have some space. Yeah, that's wiggle room. Yeah, I hope I'm being filmed on that. But that's what we mean by wiggle room. You have some space, and there is wiggle room in there. And now we don't even need that wiggle room because now we have a legal assessment that says, go ahead, you're fine. Yeah. And even recently, INCB, in their latest report, sorry. And the crucial thing is, harm reduction is allowed, but at no point is there a rule in the law that says you have to do harm reduction. Yeah? So if a country wants to ignore it, they can. That's the problem we have. But if a country wants to do it, there is nothing to stop it. Yeah? But it's not strong enough. It doesn't make a country do things. So the next one, medical cannabis. We talked a little bit about this earlier. Now, we've given that a yellow light, an orange light, okay? Because it's, the conventions allow for medical and scientific use of drugs. In fact, they don't just allow it, they're actually meant to promote the medical and scientific use of drugs, okay? So in that sense, yes, medical cannabis, no problem. The problem is, that cannabis is currently listed in a schedule that is reserved for drugs that have no medical use. So as far as the United Nations is concerned, at the moment, cannabis has no medical use, which we all know is absolute bollocks. But that's the rule at the moment. So that means that technically there is no medical use of cannabis. Yeah? So this will all become a lot easier and a lot simpler after the World Health Organization complete their review this year. Because that review is definitely going to acknowledge that there is medical value to cannabis. There's no way that it can deny that, yeah? So once that review happens, then they will have to move cannabis from where it is now to another list, and then medical cannabis will become allowed, yeah? There are things in the conventions about how to manage a medical cannabis system. So the conventions talk about having a cannabis committee, having the government control the supply, and things like that. So this is all in the conventions already, which is why this is an orange light, yeah? And certainly, well, the INCB last month released a statement about medical cannabis saying you can do it. So they've now come out for the first time and said, this is okay, but you just have to follow these rules, okay? So it's a moving target, it's allowed, but you have to do it in a certain way, okay? Now this is similar, this isn't such an issue in this part of the world, but coca production. Coca is obviously the plant that we get cocaine from, okay? Now in Bolivia, just one example, but in Bolivia, coca is a natural plant, it grows everywhere, it's part of the culture, they've used it forever. The farmers chew it, everyone in the family has coca tea, it's just part of their life. Now they, and obviously the conventions ban it, the conventions say you cannot use, sell coca. So Bolivia wanted to change that, Bolivia were desperate, they kept saying, please take coca away, you can ban cocaine, but don't ban coca. In the end, what they did, and this is why it's a yellow light, an orange light, not a green light, what they did in the end, in 2013, they actually, Bolivia left the convention, they left the treaty, they said, I'm done. But yeah, they walked away, okay? A year later, they then came back and signed on and became part of it again, but with a little note at the bottom saying, we are going to allow coca. Now, every country is allowed to do that, okay? Why did Bolivia do this? So can someone help translate?
Why did they quit and then came
because,
back?
Because they wanted to allow coca production. They wanted to have a coca market, okay? And if they stayed in the convention, they weren't allowed to do that. So their only way to do it was to leave and then to come back, but when they come back, to have a little disclaimer, yeah? Because a lot of countries, when they signed the convention, when they signed in 1961, a lot of countries had little disclaimers. India, for example, put a disclaimer saying, we're going to carry on allowing cannabis. Yeah, lots of countries had little things like this. So that's what Bolivia did. Now, if two-thirds of the countries objected, then Bolivia would not have been allowed to rejoin. Okay? But they didn't. So Bolivia got away with it. So this... Two-thirds. You need, so what is that? That must be about 100 countries. If 100 countries say you can't, no, we're not going to let you do that, then you cannot rejoin. Okay, so it was a gamble, but it worked. So that's why this isn't a green light. If you want to do this, you have to leave and then come back. Okay, and you have to take those risks.
That's another
Yeah. And Bolivia is the only country that has done this. For any, we thought that Uruguay might do it for cannabis, but they chose to go a slightly different way. It's possible that Canada might do this, but it's unlikely. Okay, but this was, when this first happened, we were all very excited because we thought a lot of countries would do the same. Now this is the last one, but I just put it up here to put things in perspective. This is a red light, okay? And this is having a legal market for recreational drugs. Having a situation where drug use is allowed, where you can buy one of these drugs freely on the market and use it and not face any sanction. Okay? So this is what we have. We had this in Uruguay for cannabis. We had this in California and lots of other states in the US. We have it, or we will have it very soon in Canada. Okay? But it is not allowed in the convention. And it's very interesting to watch each country try to negotiate, you know, and try to explain what they're doing, you know. In America, for example, they say that because cannabis is still banned by the American government, they are not in breach of the convention. And they have no control over what happens in California. Yeah? Canada, I think Canada, we don't know for sure, but I hope that when Canada creates its legal cannabis market this year, that they will be honest about the fact that
bigger countries have
breaking the law.
Greater chances to say they're breaching.
Yes, that's the thing.
For Canada, it was like
Canada is a strong country.
Yeah.
Okay. So I hope that Canada is brave enough to just turn around and say, "Yeah, we're doing this because we think it's right, but it's not allowed.
Yeah.
But we're doing it anyway." Yeah. And it's going to be very interesting to see. So I just wanted to give you that idea about what is and what isn't allowed, because people, when we talk about the conventions, people assume it's just a war on drugs, and it's all about arrest people, put them in prison, death penalty, all these kind of things, okay? If you actually read the conventions, they're really not like that, yeah? That's just the way that they've been interpreted over the last 60 years. And a lot of the things that we want to do, we are allowed to do. There's no reason why government should object. And it's really important that you know that, so that if you're talking to your government and they turn around and say, oh, we can't do that because of the conventions, it's really important that we know the argument and that we're able to turn around and say, yes, you can do it. And not only can you should. It's really important that we do that as civil society, okay? Should we take a break? Well, are there any questions first?
Well, just one comment. One comment. Okay, remember, when the country plans to make it, come into the breach of the convention, the argument is that there are many nice UN treaties that we need, like protection of children, etc., you know, and by, you know, delegitimizing some UN conventions that way, you kind of are putting in question the whole UN international law system in a way, and that's being used as an argument. Even if you're right, if you have the right approach, you're kind of bringing down UN as an, you know, legitimate system, you know, bringing international law, etc. So that, and for small countries, of course, it's difficult because, you know, there's a lot of political price to be paid. Georgia, I'm sure, will never declare they are in a breach with UN laws. I mean, that would be too costly for them.
Well, from what you're proposing, though, they're not in breach.
Yeah, we are.
I mean, that's really, it is really important point, and I know Uruguay got a lot of criticism for doing what they did. And I know that Canada, there was already pressure on Canada because they're doing the same thing. I mean, ultimately, the way that the UN system works is, I personally believe that breaches will be a good thing because it will force the entire system to change and to become better, yeah? And to adapt itself so that this is no longer a red light. You know, to change it so that this becomes a green light. So I personally believe that it's a good thing.
Someone
has to push, you know, push it forward. But we'll see. We'll see what Canada do. It's going to be a really interesting year because of the WHO review, which we're expecting before Christmas, and because of Canada, it's going to be a very interesting year. And the CND in March will be an interesting meeting to see, yeah, see what happens. Okay, let's have a coffee.
Yeah.